Hopefully you made it through Hurricane Sandy without too many problems. We're going to talk a little bit more about Hurricane Sandy and some hurricane issues a little bit later and how they affected your car and maybe how they will affect your future car. And we're going to be joined in a little bit with automotive shop owner, auto writer, and noted kind of car enthusiast, Junior Damato. We're working on getting him on the phone. And a couple of interesting things in the news. Ford is giving the new Ford Explorer a sportier treatment. The Ford Explorer Sport will take its place at the top of the Explorer line as a performance model, much as the SHO occupies the space for the Taurus. The Explorer Sport, already at dealerships, has sporty graphics. Most significantly, it gets a 3.5-liter twin-turbo EcoBoost six-cylinder engine that powers the SHO. It cranks out 365 horsepower and is the most powerful EcoBoost in the lineup and still gets 22 miles per gallon on the highway. And this is going to be in the new Explorer Sport. Ford engineers used some of the lessons they learned designing the Police Interceptor vehicle to give the Explorer Sport its performance-oriented driving dynamics. Well, it's still an SUV. It's only going to be so dynamic, I think. But Ford designers made liberal use of black to set the Explorer Sport apart. Black wheels with the Sport logo engraved are standard, along with a black roof rack, blacked-out headlamps and taillight treatments, black side mirrors, and blackened grille and lower front fascia. Sounds pretty interesting. And at the opposite end of excess, I guess, the Tata Nano. That was that $2,500 car that was available in India. A redesigned version of India's no-frills Nano microcar will come to the United States in 3 years, said the owner of Tata, the billionaire who owns the company. The U.S. is a very enticing market. He said in an interview, we're redesigning Nano for both Europe and U.S. He said the new Nano will be far more sophisticated than the ultra-cheap model that has flopped in India despite real-world hype. It'll get a bigger engine, more bells and whistles, including such features as power steering and traction control. It'll be priced below $10,000. So a cheap car coming from India. It's kind of interesting, the Tata Nano, which was a $2,500 car, and interesting to know that that's a flop in India, is the same company owns Jaguar and Range Rover. With us on the phone is our buddy, approved auto repair shop owner, auto writer, and car enthusiast, Junior Damato. Good morning, Mr. Junior.
Good morning, Mr. John. How are you today?
Good. How are you?
Another day in paradise. We're just living the dream.
Are you?
Yeah, lots of living dreams that we're seeing in these days.
Oh, there you go. And just to check on you, living down at the lake. Everything's okay down there?
The lake is absolutely phenomenal. Did not lose any electricity. About 5 o'clock that day of the hurricane, because we happened to close down a couple of hours early to give the guys time to get home and do all this stuff. A couple of guys on jet skis go by waving. Stand-up jet skis. These guys are doing the thing that they do. We're not talking about kids. We're talking about guys our age on jet skis, wearing wetsuits, having a ball the day of the storm.
Well, there you go.
Well, how's everything at the car doctor program?
What was that?
How's everything at the car doctor program?
Everything at the car doctor program is just fine.
I tuned in about a week or so ago. Unfortunately, I'm one of those guys that have to work on Saturdays, and whenever I can, I definitely tune in, and I heard a lot of old friends talking to you and say, hey, what about that guy, Junior? And I know there was one guy down the Cape that listens on his crazy radio with a crazy antenna and all the rest of the guys, and I was glad to hear them, and I'm glad that you have taken over all the realm in the area of the talk radio for cars on Saturday morning.
Well, somebody's got to be stupid enough to keep doing it. That's you were doing it for what, 25 years?
25 plus, probably 35. Myself and Bugsley Lawler were doing that national program out of our house down in Buzzards Bay on the canal. Probably 35 years ago.
Yeah,
Tom Starr was around.
It was a long time ago, and I'm just keeping the legacy going. What can I say?
You have got the legacy going, and let's talk about some cars and some crazy stuff and have some fun. And I got to tell you, without the help of you know, Mitchell's All Data and Identifix, this would not be an easy business to be in. It is incredible.
Absolutely. And I talked to more people who have decided that, you know, they're gonna just go into another line of business because they're not able to keep up, or they're not able to keep up with the information they need to get. And you need all of it. All data has some of it. Mitchell has some of it, and Identifix has some of it as well.
Well, here you go. You ready for this? A couple of real quick ones, then we can chit-chat. A couple of interesting problems. We have a Volvo, hypothetically. No, hypothetically. We have a Volvo S80 or S60, whatever model it is. Electronic throttle is going bad, the throttle body, okay? When that goes bad, do you realize it also can shut coils and injectors off? Would never believe that. O2 Buick LeSabre, okay?
Mm-hmm.
Blows heat out of one side, not out of the other. Would you ever in your whole life think that a partly blocked heater core can cause it? Unbelievable.
No, it's funny. I got a question about a Honda, might have been a Civic or an Accord, from somebody who said they had this similar problem. They had warm air coming out of one side of the duct, and the other side they had air conditioning. Yep. It was cool air coming out of the other side. And I said, you know, looking at something, I said, it looks like it's a blend door issue, some kind of blockage. And actually with those Hondas, if the system is a little low on charge, for some reason, it's cool on one side and warm on the other side.
The same holds true if it's a little bit low on coolant, believe it or not.
Yep.
Really crazy. Anyway,
yep.
You and I are probably one of the most privileged people, I think, in the area. We've earned it. We've paid our dues. You and I, along with about probably 45 other people or so, get a different car to drive on a weekly basis to evaluate. And people think, oh, man, you got a new car every week. That's got to be great. Well, in some cases, it's very good, but the manufacturers expect feedback on these particular cars that you and I, a lot of times you'll get a car first and then I'll get it, or vice versa,
mm-hmm.
and I may not get the same car that you get out of the press pool here from AutoMotion Incorporated.
Yep.
And, you know, we both shared a Corvette this past week or two that I had the car one day and I had to send it back. You made a note on the car, I guess, because you had it before me.
Yep.
And this particular Corvette was a commemorative edition 427, back to the old days. And someone in New York at the track had pulled out the exhaust fuse, so the exhaust was wide open.
Mm-hmm.
And, of course, when you're going 140, 150 miles an hour on the track, continually with multiple journalists hitting the brake rotors go out around.
And they were.
Woof. And I got to tell you, I had the car Monday. I made a phone call. They picked that car up at noontime on Monday. And they had the car back to me on Wednesday. What a beautiful car to drive. And, John, I tell you, it'd be great if you could get that car again with the exhaust so quiet. It is amazing. It's a rocket ship undercover.
Yeah, it really was. That was, I don't know if I was prepared to be a little disappointed, and when I drove that car, how incredibly quick that car was. That you need to own a tire store to own that.
Now,
that car.
That car had some different tires on it, and they get very sticky once you heat them up, just like a drag strip. Now, that's basically a Z06 in disguise without all the aluminum underneath it. It still had a steel frame, so it's a bit heavier than a Z06 and the ZR1, but you know what? That's one car that you can drive or ride in, and the choice is yours. And if it was an automatic, most ladies could drive the car.
Yeah, but no, that was...
Before I forget, I'm sitting down last night at the Chatterbox restaurant down here in Bridgewater, and I'm getting up to leave, and a gentleman says, Junior, I really miss hearing you on the radio. I says, yeah. I said, who are you, Jack? And they went the whole thing. They adopted the kid and all this stuff. Really, really nice people. And I said, well, listen, we're going to be doing it with John Paul this morning. John, yeah, where is he? I tell him John's right locally here on 950 out of Boston. I'll be tuning in. So a big hello to Jack and his wife, and I hope they'd enjoy their nice Thai meal last evening.
I got to go to I've heard a lot of good things about that restaurant. I got to try that restaurant out one day.
If you go down to there, you got to go in and ask for Mindy.
Mindy?
Mindy. And then you got to ask her, do you have any Land O'Lakes butter? And she'll just probably roll over and just start laughing like crazy. Because, you know, these restaurants do not have butter. And Carla likes to have a little butter on her rice.
Yeah.
She actually went out and got a pound of butter and put it in the freezer.
Just for you.
Yeah, it was amazing. But anyway, that's one car that we had. We had a bunch of other cars back-to-back, and I got to tell you, John, some of the later model cars, the newer cars, the economy cars, like, you know, we both, I think, shared the Honda with the camera on the side view mirror.
Yep.
God forbid, what's that going to cost to replace?
I know. Sometimes you got to wonder that, you know, this technology is all good and all, but, you know, what happens when you take out a front camera off a Jeep Grand Cherokee or something?
Yikes.
You know, that all of a sudden, that little bump in one of those parking lot bumpers just turned into a $1,000 repair.
Yeah. Now, let's talk a little bit about, and I think you can relate to this before we go on, about the new cars. And I noticed one thing, and you can correct me if I'm wrong or right or whatever. The isolation on the suspension is just incredible. Even Chrysler has gotten rid of all of the banging over bumps.
Yeah, I mean it's come a long way since they had torsion bars that rattled your teeth out of your car.
Let's go back to the old days again with the Caravan and the K cars.
Yep.
I remember getting into one of these cars and do not turn the wheel hard, you know, left to right all the way unless you're moving,
right?
Because the subframes wouldn't take it. I'll never forget that.
That's right. Yep.
And
so you're right. The small car. I'm driving a Chevy Malibu right now, and the car has a lot of good stuff going for it and a lot of stuff that it's probably the most uncomfortable seats of any car I've ever been in.
Okay, now let's get into a discussion about seating, because this is something that a lot of people complain about. Who does John Paul think he is? Those seats are uncomfortable for him. Well, Junior Damato happens to like those seats. Well, John Lawler may not like the seats. One of the things we see...
Joanne Paul doesn't like those seats either, by the way. Joanne Paul doesn't like those seats
either. Mrs. John Paul's wife?
Yeah.
Oh, Joanne. She's a wonderful lady. Hey, by the way, I'm still not 100% happy with you. You brought down... Joanne made some wonderful, wonderful chicken pot pies for your nephew.
Yeah.
And what am I, Swiss cheese?
Yeah.
I didn't even get it?
Joanne, yeah, okay, next time.
Okay,
next
back
time.
To the seating. There are some people like yourself. You're a very, very, you know, tall and well-structured guy. Where I'm a lot shorter, those seats may fit me, but people may not know. Just because that seat doesn't fit you the way you want it to, you can still buy that car, and yes, you have to spend the money to get that seat to conform the way you want it to be. I have a Volvo right now, and I'm not that happy with the seats. We had a Nissan a week or two ago, and the seat, well, you know, it, give or take it.
Yep.
But the people can... do the seat and make the seat conform to their body for not a whole lot of money anymore.
Yeah, and some of these seats with the where the seat covers are actually got a zipper in them, a little bit of memory foam under this between the cover and the rest of the seat can have a huge improvement in comfort for people.
Yep, and you know what we use a lot of times is egg crate foam.
Yep, same
idea. The ones that you put on your bed, and it gives you I think a whole lot of support. Gas mileage, John, is incredible in all of these cars today, as is the power, the quietness. It seems like heated seats are more found often than not now in today's cars, where heated seats, you know, years ago were just on the high-end cars.
Yep.
Heated steering wheels are something that we never thought of. And even Mercedes-Benz has heated steering wheels.
Absolutely.
And if you remember in the day, the Mercedes built the car, you take it or leave it. This is the way we do it. Now they can structure a car around what John Paul and Mrs. John Paul would like to have.
It's funny. I haven't driven a Mercedes in a while, but I drove a BMW not that long ago. I think it had $25,000 worth of options in it.
Can you believe that? You can buy two cars for that.
That's right. That's right. Even that Corvette had $15,000 worth of options in it.
Oh, that was crazy. Yeah. One thing that I think we can get away from for a moment is a lot of people with all of the leaves and all the hurricanes and all the stuff that we just went through, those cabin filters in the car, some of the cars, people can actually change those cabin filters themselves. Not a big deal in most cars, unless you have a Subaru, we have to take half the dashboard apart. You just can't pull the glove box out to get to the cabin filter. But most of the cars, whether it be a GMC truck, an Audi, Cadillac, Buick, Lexus, Toyotas especially, no big deal to change those cabin filters. And again, I know that you talk about this often. Open the hood, get all the leaves and debris out from the bottom of that windshield, because all that crap ends up going down into the heater box over time.
Absolutely does. Hey, do you have a few minutes to hang on?
I can do anything Mr. John Paul wants, because you are driving Miss Daisy this morning.
All right. Well, you stay right there. We need to pay a few bills. You're listening to the Car Doctor program on AM 950 with our guest, Junior Damato. We'll be back in just a couple of minutes. And we're going to, when we come back, we're going to talk not just about leaves that go into the heater system and the air conditioning system, but some of these flood cars that are going to be coming out of New Jersey and New York. My name's John Paul. This is the Car Doctor program on AM 950. We'll be right back.
A discussion on suicide is heating up in Massachusetts, and it all started with the Death with Dignity Bill, ballot number 2. Did you know that this bill promotes suicide for those who are ill, many who are elderly, disabled, and poor? What is wrong with our intellectual society? The more suicide is promoted for society's weakest members, the worse example it becomes for our young people. The suicide rate is already too high for our young people. So when we don't protect our elderly, disabled, and poor, we put our youth at risk, along with the rest of the population. What are you doing, Massachusetts? What our young people really need is for society to affirm that they are loved, important, and cared for, from birth right up until death. Ballot number 2 gives physicians a power they've never had before, the right to prescribe medication to a patient with the intent of ending that person's life. Remember Dr. Death, Jack Kevorkian? Get with it, Massachusetts. Vote no on question 2.
The bill pays shuffle. You just did it. Can't pay this bill, stall this bill, pay this bill or else. Shuffling bills, loans, and working overtime are not your answer. Earning more money is, but you have so little time. IncomeAtHomeUSA.com. With a computer and a bit of time and desire, you could be banking serious money from your kitchen table. No home sales parties and no pressure. IncomeAtHomeUSA.com has been helping our listeners for over 10 years. So stop the bill pay shuffle. IncomeAtHomeUSA.com. Listeners, here's an amazing way to earn quit your job money from home. IncomeAtHomeUSA.com wants listeners who want to work from home.
I have to tell you, it's the best decision that I ever made because we replaced my income and my husband's income. This business has allowed us to quit our jobs, and we're both at home full-time and loving it. Best decision I ever made.
They're even giving away $1,000 to someone just for checking them out. IncomeAtHomeUSA.com. IncomeAtHomeUSA.com. IncomeAtHomeUSA.com.
Now, let's get back to the Car Doctor, John Paul.
And welcome back to the Car Doctor program on AM 950 WROL. My name is John Paul. With us on the phone is Junior Damato. And before we went to break, we're going to talk about flood cars. But in between the commercial, our buddy Rick from Boston called in, and he had a question about, he was reading the AAA publication, and we'll get to his question in a minute, but he mentioned something about, he was reading the publication, and he saw the Phantom Gourmet's Great Eats, and it reminded me of the Andelmans, and one of the first times I was on the radio, I was on your show, and I think it was right before or right after Eddie Andelman was on.
That was the old days.
The old days. And where was that?
Could have been the middle of the dial, RKO,
yeah,
HDH,
yeah,
or could
those,
have been
yeah.
even 68 on the dial back
yeah,
in
something.
Those days, or whatever
yeah.
it was, they called it. But Melvin X. Melvin from WMEX was actually the program manager. Then Al Mayers took over.
Oh, yeah, Al Mayers.
He went to New York, where he still is.
Yep.
Peter Casey was just a producer. Now, as we all know, he's pretty much the chief political and chief officer over and then manager over at 10:30. So
yeah.
Things have really evolved in this radio business since you and I have done this.
That's right. Hey, you got lucky down where you live. Your shop got lucky, or both your shops are lucky that no damage. I'm pretty lucky. I haven't been to the Cape yet. I don't know how things are there, but I'm hoping mm-hmm. for the best. But in New York and New Jersey, not so lucky, but whenever there's floods, there always means there's these really good deals on cars that 2 or 3 months later start to show up in the market. What do you see for flood cars over the last few storms?
Well, we talked about this, in fact, with our buddy Rod Fritz on 10:30 about maybe a month ago because of the problems, 6 months you know, before that. But you'll find that these flood cars will start showing up in, I'm going to say, we're into what, November, October, December, probably sometime around February, March, we'll start to see a lot of these cars coming to roost because, let's face it, they put these cars aside right now. And speaking about these cars, if you get a car from, let's say, with a New York title or a fresh title, you got to go back and look at it. And one thing about Carfax, they can give you that information. All right, let's say that you and I are in New York, okay, and we're running a scammy used car lot, which, you know what, that does happen. And we say, look, we got to get these titles taken care of. So what we're going to do is we're going to retitle these cars, which is not illegal in any way, shape, or form, to our Florida address and pay the transfer fees. And now we have Florida titles on these cars. When you go and you buy a car, you can Carfax it by the VIN number, and it will tell you where this car has been and where it's been titled and the mileage. So that's one thing really good about that Carfax system that they have and some of the other programs that are out there and services. But remember, the Carfax is only what gets reported.
Right.
Let's say that we had a dent in a fender or whatever, a sideswipe. We paid it out of our pocket. We didn't put a claim in. You've got no idea.
Yeah. No, I was talking to somebody yesterday who was looking at a 2006 Honda CR-V. It was California titled in 2006. The next day, and this is where it got a little confusing, the next day it was registered in Massachusetts. It had 6,000 miles on it in a day. So something happened to it. And then it sat for about 2 years, didn't seem to accumulate any mileage, and then it seemed to have some normal 4,000 or 5,000 miles a year for a couple of years after that. So there was some, you know, you have to wonder, did something happen where it got titled and retitled again and paperwork got confused or something?
Well, someone made just a typo.
Yeah, somebody could have made a typo and that's all it is, but it was enough to make, I think it was enough to make the car a little suspicious that definitely somebody should get it checked out before they buy it. And also, it might be a good negotiating tool, too, to say, hey, look, you know, this car's got a pretty questionable Carfax. You guys want, you know, $15,000 for it. I might be willing to take a chance at $12,000.
Exactly right. But again, before anybody does anything, and I know that I'm still in the grease pit, but before you got the high position that you're in with AAA, you were in the diagnostic center doing the diagnostic service and checks. And anybody that buys a used car for $75, go to any of the AAA approved shops, or I would think most of them should be able to, you know, meet your wishes and do a used car evaluation that vehicle.
It's amazing what you found when you pulled a spare tire down, you know, out of something and found out that, you know, the car looks spotlessly clean, but the 8 inches of mud that was built up under the spare tire where the car might have been in a flood or might have been, you know, used off-road with not the kindest of attitudes.
Incredible. You know, a lot of people have called me with AAA on the bandwagon with this Right to Repair Act and Vote 1, yes, no. One of my, you know, my AAA representative was around a couple of weeks ago. We put some signs up for him and give out these brochures. You know, the one problem I have with this whole, ballot that they're trying to do is, let's say, if this is a political issue, no matter how you cut it, yes, we are being heard. Are we going to make any difference? Is it actually going to go in our direction? They did pass it, but they passed it with a proviso and made some changes. And that's usually the way things like this happen when it comes to trying to do anything with government and the higher-ups, with the passing of any legislation or any law. But anything is better than nothing. That's the way I look at it.
That's right. And you're right. Something got passed in July. It was a compromise. It got passed at 9 o'clock at night on the last day of the session. They took away some stuff, and some of the things they took away was, you know, the motorcycle, the RV people had no input in this at all now. And also the whole issue of who actually owns the information, the telematic stuff of it. You know, you're driving your brand-new car, and it's transmitting and receiving information all day long. I think you should be the one who has control over that, not the car companies.
I've got no argument with you. Yep. It's like my neighbor said to me, you know what? He says, I get these emails all the time from OnStar that my car needs this, my car needs that. And because they're Big Brother's watching your mileage, your tire pressure. And in some cases, Shawnee, it's very, very good. In other cases, give me a break. Leave me alone. Let me just shut the OnStar off.
Yeah. Well, and that's where OnStar got in trouble about a year ago when a bunch of subscriptions expired. They still kept tracking all the information and sending reports out to third-party companies to try to sell, oh, your car's gone this many miles now. You might want to consider an extended warranty. Your car's done this. You might want to do that. And OnStar did it without telling anybody.
Yeah, well, that shouldn't have been done. Let's talk real quickly about, you know, I get all these time-sensitive envelopes in the mail. Your car is now out of warranty. Call this 1-800 number. You know what? Half of these or three-quarter of these warranties are not worth the paper they're written on. They want you to use new kind quality parts. A lot of times they won't let you buy original parts. They may have the parts shipped over from a company called Rock Auto Supply.
Yep.
And there are so many substandard auto parts that are out there, number one. Number two, they want to pay a minimal labor rate. And this is the biggie. They'll only pay up to a particular dollar amount on that particular policy. So you got to really, really, really be careful.
Yeah, most of those, I tell people, they're a good way to start a fire in a fireplace. Yeah.
That works. The other thing is that for many, many years, AAA has been associated with extended warranty companies, and never, ever, ever, ever have we had any kind of a problem with anything to do with a AAA extended or endorsed warranty that people have got through. AAA, you can say that I had to wait 3 hours to get my car towed in the middle of a snowstorm. What do you think? How many other people are out there?
Yeah.
I hear this all the time. You know what? When you need the AAA people, they are there, and the drivers they have are probably more courteous than some of the waitresses you have working in a controlled environment waiting for that 20% tip.
That's right. In fact,
so, you know, you got to give these guys credit.
Yeah. In fact, right now we're actually helping out the New Jersey AAA club because they're out of electricity and out of, I don't think they got their phones on yet, but they may have gotten some partial electricity back. So we're actually taking some of the road service calls. And one of the things we're finding out is people are sort of forgetting. They're going out in their car and they're recharging their cell phones, they're recharging their laptops, and then they're calling us 2 days later and saying, my battery's dead.
Unbelievable.
And they don't want to start their car because the gas stations out there don't have electricity, so they can't pump gas or they can't get deliveries. So they're sitting out there with their key on trying to charge up their cell phone and charge up their computers so they have access to the internet, and then they're killing their batteries. So just as a kind of a reminder, you know, batteries today, as good as they are, you know, you can't use them for a generator to, keep all your electrical appliances up.
That's very, very true. And when it comes to batteries, you want to make sure you buy a good battery, the most cold cranking amp battery that you can buy for that particular vehicle. This is where bigger is always better.
Yeah, always buy the best battery you can afford to buy.
You really got to be careful with that. And the other thing that you're going to see within the next probably 60 to 90 days or less, the prices of used cars in the Northeast are going to go through the roof because of the floods. I talked with a company, C&K, down in New Jersey yesterday, where we get some good wholesale pieces, real nice cars.
Mm-hmm.
Junior, you know what? He says, we're probably not going to be doing business till probably sometime May or June now. I said, what happened? He says, with the floods that we had, we have taken the prices of all our vehicles. We're not price gouging, but to replace the vehicles that we're selling a $5,000 car. It's going to cost me over $6,000 at the auction now to buy that car.
Yep.
So we'll be coming up to Framingham. We'll be going down to Pennsylvania. And, it's like the Obama thing when we had that cash for clunkers. This is going to hurt a lot of used car lots.
Yeah, it is. And I mean, used cars have been at a premium for the last couple of years, ever since all the economy fell apart and people weren't buying cars and people weren't leasing cars and cars weren't showing back up on the market. Used cars have been at a real premium. And even to the point where, what's a junk car worth today?
$400? Just went up yesterday to just under $200 a ton.
Yep.
The average car can bring, even though it may not weigh 2 tons, $300 to $500, depending on how many catalytic converters it has, John, how much aluminum it has, and here's one, if it has alloy wheels or steel wheels.
Yep.
It's crazy. And, you know, this is where it's at. And the other thing I think you could touch on real quickly is there's just so many things to talk about when it comes to cars, is these 1995 oil changes. You go in there, a lot of times the customer doesn't realize that that service writer that's getting all their information, writing everything down for that 1995 oil change, is an independent company that comes in and then gives you a beautiful portfolio on all the recommended services that you may or may not need. Always get a second opinion for what's needed and the price.
Absolutely. It always makes sense. Hey, we're going to have to figure out a little technology here. We can get you on the air and take calls at the same time. We didn't want to chance it this morning because we haven't done that before in this studio. So
whenever you're ready, you do whatever you want. We'll be there to help you.
We'll be there, and we'll get some callers on the air and people that haven't connected with you in a long time. We'll be able to do that. How's that?
So
I'll let you go back to work, making money, doing fixing people's cars, and you know, keeping the economy going. Give you a little plug. 1318 River Street in Hyde Park, and what's the address down in Middleborough?
We're here at 359 West Grove Street, which is Route 28 in Middleborough right now, and Joe did bring in a little, am I right, John? I'm a small little piece of that fabulous, you know, turkey pot pie.
Oh, so he went through all the leftover Chinese food that we gave him?
Yeah, he gave me that, yeah.
All right.
That was great. Hey, listen, you have a great day. Say hello to the wife, and again, to all of the listeners, it's great hearing me mentioned on John's program. John is number one when it comes to the car programs here, all of New England.
All right. Take care, Junior.
Take care, buddy.
All right. See ya. Junior Damato, long time. I've been at AAA for 27 years. I've known him for 27 years, I guess. So longer than Marita's been alive. We need to take another break. When we come back, we'll talk about Rick from Boston's question. If you have a question, 617-77... I forgot the number. 617-770 is 3030. Wow. What's wrong with me? 617-770-3030 is our number. You'll have to call in and tell me what the phone number is. That's all there is to it. My name is John Paul. This is the Car Doctor program, heard exclusively on AM 950 WROL, the Spirit of Boston.
Today we're asking people to name their one favorite meal for one from Stouffer's.
One favorite? Stouffer's lasagna. But how about the barbecue chicken?
Grilled white meat chicken coated with a sweet and tangy sauce with a side of cheesy potatoes topped with crisp bacon.
Yes.
So that's your one Stouffer's favorite.
Oh, but I also like Stouffer's meatloaf.
Classic meatloaf with a rich tomato glaze, smothered in a savory gravy with a tasty side of... Hey, where are you going?
You kidding? The store.
Stock up on all your favorite Stouffer's meals for one today.
What if you could do something for your kids right now to get them ahead in school and keep them ahead for their whole life? You'd do it, right? Any teacher will tell you the kids who read better and retain what they read get better grades. We found that poor reading isn't because kids are lazy. It's because they're overwhelmed and were never taught the right way to read. Well, now you can turn poor grades around, even to A's, because for the first time ever, one of the most prestigious universities in the country, the University of California, helped create a reading program for children everywhere. It's the new phonics game, guaranteed to improve your child's grades by at least one full letter in English, reading, or spelling on their next report card.
For a limited time, the new Phonics Game is offering their free home reading checker so you can see exactly where your child needs to improve. This is a $50 value and it's free, but you must call now. Call 1-800-380-9030. That's 1-800-380-9030. Call 1-800-380-9030.
Listen up, all Salem Radio Boston listeners. Now you can listen to WROL AM 950, WEZE AM 590, and WWDJ Radio Luz AM 1150 through your iPhone, iPad, a tablet, BlackBerry, or Android phone. With iHeartRadio, just go to your favorite app store, search for the iHeartRadio, download it to your device of choice, and start listening today.
You're listening to The Car Doctor.
If everybody had an ocean across the USA, then everybody'd be serving like California. You see them wearing their baggies.
And welcome back to the Car Doctor program on AM 950 WROL, the Spirit of Boston. Some trivia today. And it's kind of a, I guess it's not. I don't know quite how to describe it. But Racing legend and safety pioneer John Fitch died this week. You don't have to feel too bad for John. He died at age 95. And he was a racing legend, kind of in the glory days, drove some of the best and most notorious race cars I think were ever been around. John Fitch was also somebody who is kind of a local guy. He lived in Connecticut, but I want to say he may have originally been from the Worcester area or somewhere around this area is maybe where he originally was from. But he was 95 years old, and he just passed away. But John Fitch also is credited with a safety innovation. And if you know the answer to what this safety innovation is, we'll give you something. Might be some wax for your car, might be some cleaner for your headlights, but it'll be something. And but right now, let's go to line one. Let's talk to Jim in Boston. Hey, Jim.
Oh, hi, John.
Hi.
First of all, I want to wish you a happy Thanksgiving. Probably going to be out of town.
Oh, okay.
Two is, I see that the Hucksters are back with some gadget that's going to increase your gas mileage. Have you heard them on the radio?
I haven't heard this one. What's this one?
It's supposed to increase your mileage up to the good old up to.
Up to.
18%. I think they operate out of an abandoned bus on the New Jersey Turnpike.
Yeah. That's like the, you know, all that stuff. It'll make you look up to 10 years younger. You can lose up to 100 pounds.
In a week and a half,
yeah.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. I just wanted to get it out there.
All it usually does is it makes you have up to less money than you had when you started.
Yes. And yeah. I know a lot of piston heads like to listen to your show, as I do, and they'll probably know, but they'll probably tell people that don't know that, in fact, it's a ripoff. See you later.
All right, take care.
Bye.
Happy Thanksgiving. Bye-bye. Okay, our trivia question again was, racing legend and safety pioneer John Fitch invented some safety innovation. What was it? Give us a call at 617-770-3030, 617-770-3030. And while you're doing that, I want to talk about the all-new 2013 Chevy Malibu. It comes in several trim levels, the LS, the LT, and the LTZ. In addition, there is the Malibu Eco, which uses a fuel-saving e-assist partial hybrid technology, sort of a starter-type device. Engine choices, in addition to the 182-horsepower hybrid, are a 2.5-liter four-cylinder rated at 197 horsepower and a 2-liter turbocharged engine rated at 259 horsepower. Two different 6-speed automatic transmissions are offered depending on engine choice. Our road test was in the Malibu LZ with the 2-liter turbocharged engine. On the road, the Malibu's quiet. It delivers a very smooth ride. Our test car had the optional 19-inch wheels and tires, and the ride was still smooth, quiet, and controlled. Sometimes when you go from the smaller wheel to a little bit larger wheel, you have less sidewall, so you have a little bit firmer ride. The ride was very good. The 2-liter turbocharged engine delivered spirited performance with 60 miles an hour, arriving in about 6.5 seconds. The engine itself tends to sound a little rough around the edges, not quite as sophisticated as turbocharged engine from Europe. The 6-speed automatic transmission shifts smoothly and, to me, seemed to nicely match the characteristics of the engine. The steering was smooth, fairly precise, and actually much more responsive than other earlier GM models that I've driven. The brakes are four-wheel disc that may be some of the best for any midsize car. The brakes are firm, offer good control stops, and according to everything that I've read, can stop this car from 60 miles an hour in anywhere from 112 to 115 feet. Fuel economy from the turbocharged engine was also quite good. I average about 25 miles per gallon overall. EPA rates the car at 21 miles per gallon in the city and 30 miles per gallon on the highway. I hit the highway mileage every time I was in it. My drive back and forth to work is about 10 miles of city driving and about 40 miles of highway driving. In that average, so not strictly highway, but in that average, I was getting 30 miles a gallon, even up to 31 at some time. The interior of the Malibu has some hits and misses. The front seats have plenty of adjustments and should satisfy drivers of nearly every size. Headroom was quite good, even with the sunroof taking up some interior space. The seats themselves are firm, but not particularly comfortable. I didn't find them comfortable My wife didn't find them comfortable. Maybe Junior will. I don't know. There's decent storage throughout with a fair size glove compartment, cup holders, door pockets, bottle holders, and a novel storage compartment behind the radio. You press a button on the radio faceplate flips up, and there's enough room. There's probably a 4x6 box area. So you could put CDs, you could put a wallet in there, you could put your phone in there, you could tuck things away, and nobody would ever see it. And it's neat. It's a little button, and the thing flips up, kind of very modern car-like. But I kind of liked it. The overall fit of the interior is very good, but the choice of some of the plastic wood trim just seems cheap. The plastic wood looks like plastic wood, and the chrome looks like very plasticky chrome. The control knobs for the climate control and sound system were delightful. How often do I say delightful? Delightful in their simplicity. Yeah, two big knobs. Knob for the volume, a knob for the stations. How novel. And the climate control, same way. Knob for turns up the heat, turns down the heat. No going into multiple menus. You want to change from AM to FM, yeah, you have to touch the screen or push a button. But just the idea that you can scroll through radio station without having to really take your eyes off the road, I really kind of like that. Safety is addressed with 10 airbags, anti-lock brakes, stability control, traction control. Rear seat area is a little on the tight side, too. You put the front seats all the way back, you got to be a little teeny tiny person to fit in the back seat. Trunk is huge, though, almost 16 cubic feet of trunk space, so pretty good. This car also had the optional rear-view camera, which seems kind of odd for a sedan. Without it, though, this car is a little bit of a challenge to back up. The rear shelf that sits on the rear seat, the package shelf, actually has kind of a curve up in the back, so it actually blocks a lot of rear visibility, and the rear-view camera does a lot to do away with that. Additionally, our car had keyless push-button entry and remote car start, which was actually pretty nice this morning, so I could go out and start the car. And heated seats were nice, too. The bottom line, the 2013 Chevrolet Malibu does some things extremely well and seems to miss on others. Fuel economy, ride, and handling are very good. Some interior finishes seem a little too low cost in a car in this price range. In general, the Malibu is a very good-looking car, a solid performer, but it does have more hits than misses. I don't know. You'd have to see how you like it is the best way to describe it. I liked a lot of it, and some of it I had a little bit of a problem with. Why don't we go to Bob on line one? Good morning, Bob.
Good morning, John. How are you doing?
Good. How are you?
John, in reference to your trivia question, was that highway barriers?
Be more specific. Besides guardrails or jersey barriers, be more specific.
Let me just think a second, John.
All right.
Ding, ding, ding. What was that, jersey barriers?
Bob, you're not thinking.
I just think John said in the paper it was just highway barriers, if I remember right.
Yeah, not quite what the answer I'm looking for, but go ahead.
That's all right, John. All right. Yeah. Let's just do the jersey barrier. We'll throw that out.
No, I'm sorry.
Okay.
That's not it.
John,
all right, good
for
try.
Your time.
Good try. Thanks, Bob.
Okay, bye-bye.
All right, let's go over to line two. Let's talk to Kathy. Hi, Kathy.
Yes, good morning, John.
Good morning.
I thought you were talking about a safety feature in the car.
We are.
I was going to say seatbelts.
No, not seatbelts. Bob was close with his jersey barrier, but that wasn't quite it.
I have another question.
Okay, go ahead.
Have you used cars thinking of trading in for a new car? You think with the prices going up, I should wait?
Well, definitely used car prices are going to go up because used car prices are based on what's available in the market. And with all this hurricane stuff, and we have no idea how lucky we are when you compare to New York and New Jersey.
Definitely.
Yeah. Those are going to take cars out of the market, which is going to tighten up that market. And, if you're selling, cars or lemonade on a hot summer day, it's all about supply and demand. And when, if you're the only one selling lemonade on a 100-degree day, you can get more money for it. And if there isn't that many cars around, used cars are going to go up. So if you were thinking about trading a car in and it had some value, you might want to think about, maybe waiting another few weeks or a month before you go do that because you may get just a little bit more for your trade.
Thank you.
Okay. Thanks, Kathy.
Bye.
All right. Bye-bye. All right. Let's go over to Steve. Good morning, Steve.
Good morning. How are you?
Good. How are you?
Pretty good. I really enjoyed Junior this morning.
Well, You know, we wind him up, and then he just takes off on his own.
I know, yeah. I know. But I think the program's getting a little soft when the host starts talking about things being delightful.
Yeah, I after I read that word, I'm like, I got to take that out.
Okay. The Fitch invented something called a Fitch barrier, which was a barrel usually filled with sand or sometimes with water to put along racetracks.
That's right. That's right. That is exactly the right. That's exactly the right answer. And is he also the same guy that they? What is it? Isn't it the John Fitch Highway up in Worcester?
That I don't know, but yeah. I'll tell you. For years, I was really interested. He had a dealership in Connecticut. They were making something called Sprints, which were souped-up Corvairs.
Yep.
And they sounded like a really interesting car.
Yeah, and I think he may have owned a Lotus dealership or something at some point too. So,
yeah, that I don't know.
Yeah, but at the end of the day, I don't know that he. You know, I think a lot of people always assume that, you know, race car drivers and others, you know, when they're in their retirement years, you know, have piles of money kicking around. And I'm not sure he really did, because I know he didn't make any money on the safety barrier. I think he sold that idea for $25. Yeah.
Well, I think he saved a lot of lives.
He most certainly did. You know, all about, you know, who would have thought fill a plastic barrel with water or sand and you can save people's lives, but that's absolutely it. So, hey, I'll tell you what, we'll put you on hold and we'll give you something. How's that?
Okay, great.
All right. Thanks, Steve.
Thank you.
All right. Do you want to take a break too? Would that be good? Okay, why don't we take a break? If you're on hold, stay right there. We will get with you in just a minute or two. Marita will take down Steve's address, and we'll take a break, and I'll take a breath and drink a little coffee and, you know, sit by the side of the road here for a few minutes. My name's John Paul. This is the Car Doctor Program. You're listening on AM 950 WROL, the Spirit of Boston.
Mike Fagan's on the lot at Auto Country in Abington. Looking for a Jeep? Here's Mike.
For the off-road enthusiasts, the Jeep Wrangler, really a fun vehicle. How about a 2003 Jeep Wrangler Sport? Six-cylinder, four-wheel drive. This one has only got 49,000 miles on it, in excellent condition, and that one is $13,500. How about a Jeep Liberty, 2004, limited in black, well-maintained, a one-owner vehicle, four-wheel drive, full power equipment, and that one's $7,800. 2000 Jeep Cherokee Sport, four-door, six-cylinder, that one is $34.95.
Auto Country, located at 256 Brockton Avenue, Route 153 in Abington.
Great prices, great selection, and most of all, best value.
Stop by and visit Mike Fagan at Auto Country, or visit online at AutoCountryInc.com.
The mills closed out their excess fall inventory. We've got the flooring, and we're selling it at unheard-of prices at Lumber Liquidators' first-ever fall flooring yard sale. Get clearance flooring from just 19 cents a square foot. Laminates from only 29 cents a square foot. Pre-finished hardwood from just $1.39 a square foot. Plus, special extended financing. If you liked our famous April sale, you're going to love our first ever fall flooring yard sale. Contractors welcome. Sale starts tomorrow. Visit LumberLiquidators.com for your local store.
Now, there's a refreshing new way to experience God's story. In the Chronological Life Application Study Bible, you'll find stunning, full-color imagery and insights into God's story, presented in the order it happened. Fall in love with the story of God's Word all over again with the new way to experience the number one selling Life Application Study Bible, the Chronological Life Application Study Bible. Discover how refreshing the Bible can be at chronolifeapp.com.
Now, let's get back to the Car Doctor.
welcome back to the Car Doctor program on AM 950 WROL, the Spirit of Boston. Where are we going? Line, we're going to talk to Tom? All right. Tom, good morning.
How you doing, John?
Good. How are you?
John, I was curious. What do you think of the new Honda Accord? Well, I've never had that CVT transmission before.
Yep.
What do you... How
well,
is that?
Based on my limited experience with the car, I want to say it's the best CVT transmission of any car I've ever been in.
Okay.
Now, someone wrote to me with a concern about that car, and they said they understand they're building them twice as fast as they ever did in Ohio, and should you be concerned about any quality? I don't necessarily think so. I think Honda just builds some generally pretty good cars, and this new CVT, I'm not a huge fan of CVT transmissions, and I got to tell you, the one that I drove, now I only drove it, probably 35 or 40 minutes, and I got to tell you, the thing was, it felt as good as any transmission of anything I've been in, so I liked it a lot.
Now, when you said you weren't a fan of it, why?
Because of an issue with quality, I just don't like the way they always shift. They always feel like they kind of hang up in one RPM range. When Ford tried it with the Taurus, when it was, I don't remember if it was a 500 or a Taurus at the time, it was terrible. It turned the cars into just sluggish dogs. They weren't good cars to drive that way. Early on, probably the earliest one was the Subaru had one in a little car years and years ago that I swear they took out of a snowmobile or something. It was terrible. And then over time, I think for some makers, these kind of dual clutch transmissions, even though they have more moving parts in them because they're basically a standard transmission with two automatic clutches in it, I think just give a better overall feel. And that's what I don't have a problem with. I don't think the CVTs have any higher failure rate. I just don't like the characteristics of the way they sometimes act and behave.
I see.
But in the Accord that I drove, now granted I only drove it a little bit, I thought the thing was phenomenal.
All right. If you were picking between the Altima, the Fusion, and the Honda, that's a tough pick, though. They're all pretty nice cars.
I'd probably go Huge 2013 Fusion, although I haven't driven it. I've only just read about it. I don't know. It's one of these cars I've been reading about for a year and a half now. But I would put that, the 2013 Fusion is a really, on paper at least, it's a really good-looking car and got some really nice features in it. The Altima has grown up over time. Dependability rate, I don't think, is quite there. I want to say the Accord would probably be at the top of the list. Somebody recently just did a profile of kind of mid-sized family sedan kind of cars, and they actually put the Volkswagen Passat at the top of the list with the Accord 2. Altima was like 3 or 4, and the Chevy Malibu was down at the bottom in number
the Fusion,
5.
The Fusion has that 1.6 eco engine sort of at base. Is that a proven engine?
Well, all the eco engines are fairly new to the market, so time will tell. But performance-wise, from the engines have been really good, and I don't think Ford's in a position to make any mistakes right now because any mistakes they make could give them a lot of trouble. So I think they are working to prove out the engines to make sure they work the way they're supposed to.
All right. Well, thank you very much.
Okay. All right. Take
bye-bye.
Care. Bye-bye. Bye. Well, we had our Rick question of the week, and it sounds like it's got twists and turns.
It does.
Okay, go ahead.
Okay, kind of a cool question. It's interesting. So Rick was telling us that he saw the AAA magazine recently, and, the article that was in it with you as well. And he said that he saw either an article or an advertisement that had to do with the Phantom Gourmet and it talking about its great eats. Well, he got an idea, so he kind of put a twist on things, and he wants to know your great eights relating to cars. So
like eight-cylinder engines?
He didn't really specify. I asked him if it was models or makes, and he just kind of said in general it was just a thing he came up with.
Hmm.
So I don't know. I guess be creative with that in any way you want.
I'm going to have to save that till next week. I don't have that much creativity left. We'll see if Paul Sullivan's got any creativity left. Of course. Isn't that what it takes, is spontaneous creativity?
Well, it's at a an all-time short on Saturday mornings, right? At least for me. I've seen The Phantom and their grade eights, and whatever the classification or category they're dealing with, like if it's breakfast places, yep. I love the best eight of those, or best steaks, or best french fries.
They seem to have a fickle amount of grade eights, because it seems like they have an awful lot of them. I think if you went back in time and played some, overlapped some, you would see. I guess we're all like that. So.
Yeah. Well, you know, they every once in a while they'll ask me, "What's your favorite Irish song?" And it's always something different. It's
exactly. Yeah, you know, and like you said, your best breakfast place could be the place that you got. I don't know, an English muffin that was grilled on the grill and it just tasted good. And
right, hit the spot.
Or it could be, I don't know, some fancy buffet.
And then you rave about it, and then your friends go there and they say, "What was he talking about?"
Exactly. I try not to, when people ask me, you know, what kind of car they buy, I always ask them what they're looking at, because it never seems like I can sway anybody's opinion.
Right. Well, I think that's what Rick's getting at.
Yeah, maybe.
This microphone.
Yeah.
There you go. How come you're sitting up? Your back hurt?
A little bit, yeah.
Yeah. Tell when I came in.
Yeah, so I figured I'd sit for a while.
Yeah.
But it's funny, I ran into the Andelmans. They were in the AAA office. And the AAA office in Providence is a 100,000 square foot former department store. It was actually a Bradley's for about a day.
Yeah.
Bradley's came out of bankruptcy, opened these giant Bradley stores, and I think the next day they closed the door and locked it. And
where is it, downtown?
It's right on the Pawtucket-Providence line, right off of 95, which was not a great place to put a department store as it was.
Like around Charles Street?
But right off of 95, okay. much closer. But you're very close. Yep. You're very close. And we're across the highway from the Peter Pan bus terminal.
Oh, I know where that is.
Yeah. So,
remember, I'm a PC alum.
Oh, that's right. That's right. Yeah. Down where the old Bradley's was. So, I'm walking through the hallway and there's like two of the Andelman brothers kind of coming out of the men's room or something. And I'm like, "Hey, it's the Andelmans. What are you guys doing here?"
Causing trouble. Yeah, looking for a restaurant.
Yeah. I said, "You can't be looking for a restaurant. What are you doing here?" And they were, we structured a deal with the Phantom Cruise, and we were selling tickets for their barbecue, their big barbecue event. It was not the host. It was the other two, Mike and Dan.
Well, I mean, the Andelman name is like broadcasting legend.
Well, the guy I had on earlier, Junior Damato, I remember going in to do his show and I don't remember which station it was. One of the stations in Boston.
He's been on them all.
Yeah. And went in and, Eddie Andelman came in running in at the last minute. You know, it was one of these things that if you could come in just as your music was starting, that's when he came in. Mm-hmm. And he came in like almost like kicking the door in. You know, "Here, I'm ready to go on," you know.
Well, you know, a lot of people talk a lot about what their contribution has been, but if you talk about sports talk in Boston.
Andelman, definitely the case. Speaking of contributions in Boston.
Yeah.
The Irish Hit Parade, and you have to be one of them.
The listeners have made us a legend.
That's right.
Since 1967, year of the impossible dream.
That's right. So, what's up for the Irish Hit Parade then?
Much more legendary music.
Yeah.
Any microphone like setting into the sun.
It is. You're gonna have to adjust your chair and shrink at the same time. So, well, you notice they took away the microphone cage, the thing that with the rubber things on it. So I don't think that's helped.
Oh, I think that's absolutely right.
Yeah. So try that. Right. Maybe that'll do it.
Wish it were television. They don't know what we're talking.
I know.
About.
Well. Yeah, I think my recorder can't see you having to dive to one side to keep your microphone.
Best in Irish music
with the Irish Hit Parade.
Thanks, John.
With Paul Sullivan. And, of course, if for some reason you think this program was so good you want to hear it again, you can go to ustream.tv, find Car Doctor Radio, click on it, and you should be able to hear the program again. I'm also putting some of the programs up on YouTube so you can... watch me and Marita do whatever we do on Saturday mornings. And but right now, we have to go. Until next week, make sure you wear your seatbelt, drive safely, be good to your car. Talk to you all next week. Bye-bye.
WROL Boston.
AM 950 WROL, the Spirit of Boston.